I saw that on the Benny Hill show. Messing with the mics. Welcome all of you to church today. I am glad, we are all glad that you are here. Just a few announcements for you. The Christian Education Committee is still selling bags of peanuts for their fundraiser, and you can purchase them today. It's $5 a bag, and it comes with a free appetizer at Texas Roadhouse restaurants. The WIC group is meeting on August 16th. They will travel by Easter Seals to Hartville for lunch. If you are interested in that, please let them know so that you may join them. There is a service next Saturday, a memorial service for George Hertog, Saturday, August 14th at 11 a.m. here in the sanctuary. A couple of things to keep in mind long term as we move along. We are going to do another pictorial directory in November. Well, we're doing it in November, so if you choose to have pictures, they'll be ready to pass out for Christmas. We're also doing this because the directory company that we had from 2 or 3 years ago went out of business, and that directory, that was an online directory and a picture directory, that was no longer supported, and so we need to get another one made so that we can use that to the best of its ability. So that's in November, please keep that in mind. At the end of September, we are doing a special service of celebration, and that is to have us all come back together and honor us as a church family and as we move forward. And if things in the world change before then, we will certainly keep you up to date. But please know that September 26th is a special celebration for our church family. And once session meets in August, we'll have much more information and details to pass along. And the sympathy of the church is extended to Marilyn Chewy on the death of her husband, Philip. Phil died on July 20th. The family is having no services for him, but please keep Marilyn in your prayers. And now let us worship God.
Please join me in the responsive call to worship. Let us worship God. Let us confess that Christ is the Lord. As we worship together, let us call on the Lord.
Lord God, we need your help in living life. We get frustrated easily. We become impatient with others. We say things we later regret. We hurt those who are closest to us. We fail to live up to our own ideals. We make unwise use of our time. We enjoy nursing grudges and spreading gossip. We come to you, Lord, asking you to forgive our sins, to strengthen our resolve, and to help us live in peace with each other as Christ commands. We ask it all in His name. Friends, hear and believe the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven.
Thank you.
us pray. O God, prepare our hearts to accept your word. Silence in us any voice but your own, that hearing we may also obey your will. Amen. The scripture reading this morning is the 130th Psalm. Out of the depths I cry to you, O Lord. Lord, hear my voice. Let your ears be attentive to the voice of my supplications. If you, O Lord, should mark iniquities, Lord, who could stand? But there is forgiveness with you, so that you may be revered. I wait for the Lord. My soul waits. And in his word I hope my soul waits for the Lord more than those who watch for the morning. I say more than those who watch for the morning. O Israel, hope in the Lord, for with the Lord there is steadfast love, and with him is great power to redeem. It is he who will redeem Israel from all its iniquities.
Gracious and holy God, we thank you not only for this day, but for the offerings that have been brought forth. We ask that you would help us to disperse them within the community, to just allow our spirits to mingle with yours in understanding where the need is. We ask that you would place it upon our heart. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Lord, we ask that you would continue to allow this beautiful weather to occur. We ask for the sunshine to continue. But we also pray for the places that are receiving too much sunshine and have drought. We ask that rain would fall upon their land. We do ask that you would also be with all those who are suffering from floods, where it has rained too much. We ask that you would help them with the cleanup and the disaster relief, and remind us to continue to pray for all those who have been lost in those floods. We ask, Lord, that you would just be ever present with the world, helping us to find peace within our own nation, helping us to find peace abroad. We ask for an end to COVID-19. We ask you to be with all those who are currently suffering under the consequences of the virus, and that you would have more people be vaccinated. We ask that smaller countries would receive the vaccination so that they can send it to their people. Lord, so often there's so much that's going on with us in the world that our hearts are heavy and we have deep sighs. We ask that you would continue to watch over and be ever present with Marilyn, Jan, Chloe, Mike, Jeanette, Twyla, Paula, Sandy, Brandon, Phyllis, and Evelyn. You, O Lord, know all of their needs. We ask that they would be taken care of. We ask that they would be uplifted if they mourn. And those who are physically ill, we ask that you would heal them. We do ask, Lord, that they would receive proper care and attention to their health. We ask that you would be present with all those who are suffering from addiction and behavioral health disorders, that you would help them to seek the help that they need, that you would place it upon their hearts that you are with them and that they are loved. We ask all this in Jesus' name, as he taught his disciples to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever.
The sermon text this morning is from the book of Ephesians, chapter 4, verses 25 through 32. So then, putting away falsehood, let us all speak the truth to our neighbors, for we are members of one another. Be angry, but do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your anger, and do not make room for the devil. Thieves must give up stealing. Rather, let them labor and work honestly with their own hands so as to have something to share with the needy. Let no evil talk come out of your mouths, but only what is useful for building up as there is need, so that your words may give grace to those who hear. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, with which you are marked with a seal for the day of redemption. Put away from you all bitterness and wrath and anger and wrangling and slander, together with all malice, and be kind to one another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another, as God in Christ has forgiven you. This is the word of the Lord.
Let's in prayer. Gracious God, be with us as we hear your word, and help us to live your word, now and always. Amen. How are you at following directions? Do you ignore them? Do you meticulously read every instruction before proceeding? When all else fails, do you then consult the manual? I found some online examples of following directions. Here they are. The first one says, name the quadrilateral, and under the orange square, the student wrote Barbara. Write the following words in alphabetical order. The words are river, apple, pond. The student wrote A-E-L-P-P, apple, D-N-O-P, pond, and E-I-R-R-V, river. See, the words are in alphabetical order. The letters, that one went. Find the difference between 8 and 6. 8 is all squiggly, and 6 has a tail at the top end of it. And there's a picture of a man putting a big dog into a trash can. And next to the trash can, there's a saying that says, if your dog goes number 2, pick it up and put it in the trash. Sometimes we just need a little help understanding the instructions, comprehending the rules, grasping the right and the wrong way of doing things. And this is what Paul is doing in his letter to the Ephesians. In the verses that immediately precede today's scripture, Paul is informing the people of Ephesus that when they begin a life in Christ, things should be different. A life with Christ demands new ways of thinking and acting and treating one another. One's behavior should demonstrate a marked difference between those who live for God and those who do not. Paul tells the people to put away their old corrupted selves and put on a new self. It's like taking off clothes that no longer fit. We discard them, and from that point forward, we only wear the new clothes. The old ones are gone. In our verses for today, Paul is giving us the do's and the don'ts of the Christian life, an instruction manual, if you will. Now, I don't know what you all do with your instruction manuals. You stick them in a drawer, you throw them away, you turn to them when things go wrong. But this set of instructions today on how and how not to live for God is worth us taking a look. The first item on Paul's list, he states, we should be putting away falsehood. Let all of us speak the truth to our neighbors, for we are members of one another. Translation, don't lie, always tell the truth. That sounds simple enough until you start to discern what constitutes a lie. There's a website called the Hope Line, and there they lay out all the ways in which we lie to one another. There are white lies. Although considered the least serious of all lies, a white lie can often lead to insincerity, which over time will destroy one's credibility. There are broken promises. It's never a good idea to break one's commitment. And this action has disastrous results when the person breaking the promise never had any intention of keeping their word in the first place. There is the lie of fabrication. This involves repeating information that may or may not be true. In other words, this lie is the spreading of rumors and gossip. And the problem with this lie is that it usually involves a vindictive nature. There's the bold-faced lie. That is telling something that everyone knows is a lie. Now, this is simple, and sometimes this lie is cute. If you're a little boy or girl, and you are asked if you had a cookie, and you said no, and there's chocolate all over your face, that can be a cute thing. But that allure fades when we tell this type of lie as adults because it involves mistrust. There's the lying of exaggeration, enhancing a truth by adding lies to it, by embellishing. It seems harmful until the truth and the lies are woven together so many times the exaggeration becomes the truth. There's lies of omission. This involves not telling all the facts, creating a false impression. This is damaging because it can be justified as a way of sparing someone's pain, but a lie is still a lie. And there's plagiarism, taking the work of another and claiming it as your own. This is an especially hurtful lie, because to plagiarize is to not only lie, is also to steal at the same time. And there is compulsive lying, someone who lies even though they know that telling the truth would be easier. They usually lie to build up self-esteem and a need for attention, and do this long enough and you automatically tell the lie. So whether big or small or for the right reasons or with the best of intentions, a lie is never a fair representation of what is honorable. And to be the people of God, we must deal in the truth, which involves trust, honesty, righteousness, decency, honor, and obedience. These are all desirable traits of a truthful person and all attributes of our loving God. The difference between a truth and a lie is that in the truth there is no ulterior motive, only purity of heart. Truth comes from God, and it is that truth that should guide our behavior. Next, we are told to be angry, but do not sin. Anger in itself isn't always a bad thing. When people become angry at an injustice, it can be used as a force of change. There are examples of Jesus being angry in Scripture. The classic example is he was angry at those who were using God's temple as a means of making profit, so he came in and drove all the money changers out of the temple and returned it to a place of worship. In Mark chapter 3, Jesus was angry when the Pharisees were indignant to him healing someone on the Sabbath. He wasn't angry that they were attacking him. He was angry because they had put following the rules as more important than the need to heal a suffering person. In Scripture, when we see Jesus angry, we see it for the right reasons, and we see him dealing with it in the right way. Anger is sometimes necessary. Anger for the wrong reasons is sinful. Anger should never be used because out of selfish motives, or it should never be uncontrolled or hurtful or spiteful or done out of vengeance. And also, the sun should not go down on our anger, meaning that our anger and the reasons for it should be dealt with as soon as possible. The more we fester, the longer we wait, the slower we are to address the issue, the harder it will be to mend those fences. And when that occurs, it is easy for the devil to get a foothold into our lives, because no one holds a grudge like the person who feels they have been wronged. Moving on from anger, Paul discussed how our work should be honest labor. We shouldn't be stealing. We shouldn't be working by doing illegal things. We shouldn't be using people to get money. We shouldn't be taking shortcuts in the way we live. For if we earn a living honestly, and if we treat people rightly, then we can help those in need and do right by our fellow human beings. We are to let no evil come out of our mouths. Now, we all do this one well all the time. There is nothing as easy for us as always saying the right things. We as God's people never speak out of turn. We never say an unkind word. We never lash out because of what someone says to us or what someone says about us. Our tongues know not how to swear or say hurtful things. And if we can't say anything nice, we never, ever, ever say anything at all. That, by the way, is sarcasm. This command is the hardest one to keep and the one we need to work at the most. Here's a little tip. Before you speak for yourself, before you speak, ask yourself this question: is what I'm about to say, is it true? Is it kind? Is it necessary? That is how Christ spoke and lived. Not once were his words false. At no time did Jesus use his words to tear anyone down. And his words were designed to bring people closer to God. Paul tells us not to grieve the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is that part of God that guides us, that speaks to our hearts, that helps us through the journey of life. And just as we as human beings try not to hurt our parents or grieve them with our decisions and our choices, so too we should try to do right by God's Spirit within us. To grieve the Holy Spirit is to be sinful and unforgiving and selfish. To grieve the Spirit is to do harm to others, to ourselves, and to God by turning from God's ways. To grieve the Spirit is to deny God God's place at the center of our lives. It is to allow something or someone that place of prominence. It is any action that would hurt God. Paul ends these words of Scripture by one final list of all the things that we should be staying clear from: bitterness and wrath, anger, slander, and malice. His words are important for us as we walk alongside our Lord and Savior, because it is so easy for us to do the things that Paul urges us not to do. Paul's words remind us of God's standards and how we can avoid the pitfalls that will come our way. Paul's words give warning to the temptations that will draw us away from God. Paul's words are instructions on all behaviors that should be banished from our lives forever. These words are crucial and powerful and instructional and necessary for us to do away with our old selves and for us to put on that new self for God. But I don't want all of this to sound like a finger-pointing sermon, and I always like to give positive words and words of affirmation when I preach. So we also need to focus on those behaviors that invite God's love into our lives. We need to speak and live what is true. We need to act and do for the right reasons. We need to live and work as people of respect. We need to know that the words of our mouths are pure and kind and full of compassion and love. We need to honor God's Spirit always. You can all hear me?
No.
I've been getting some news. I'll speak as loudly as I can. Today's story is a once upon a time story, and it's about a string of ducks that were in the sky flying in that beautiful V formation. Now, before I go any further, I'm going to let you in on a pet peeve of mine. I just want to get the language right. When you get a group of ducks together, they're called a flock. But if they're on the water, they're called a paddling. And if they're in the sky, they're called a string. So you're going to hear me bounce back and forth, whether the ducks are on the ground or in the sky. But my dad taught me collective nouns, and I can't help but use them. So here we go, string of ducks in the sky, flying in that beautiful V formation. And anyone on the ground who would look up and see them, it was just an awesome sight to see the ducks. And although they looked beautiful from the ground, there was trouble brewing among the ducks. Because there was one duck, and we'll call him Drake. Thank you for those that got that. And Drake was unhappy because he was tired of being that duck. He was tired of always flying in the V formation and always flying south for the winter and always being the obedient little duck that fit into that box. He wanted to know what life was like on the other side. He wanted to know how the other ducks lived. He wanted to be a country duck. He wanted to be the duck that lived by the lake, the ones that you would feed in the pond. And on this particular day, as they're flying by, he looks down and he sees a farm. And on the farm, he sees lots of ducks running around. And he wants to try this new kind of life. Nothing drastic. He just wants to check it out. So he makes a sharp left and he dive bombs down and he lands on the farm. And he introduces himself to the other ducks and they quack along and they get to know each other. And there's other barnyard animals on the farm, so he has an opportunity to make friends with the cows and the chickens and the pigs. You know, and there's corn. All the corn. I'm gonna dance in there. All the corn he could possibly want to eat. And so he decided he would stay here for a few months. And when the string comes by and flies overhead, he would join them again and he would be that kind of duck. And for a few months, he enjoyed himself eating the corn and talking to the chickens and pigs, and everything was fine, this new kind of life. There was a lake nearby and he could do all the things that he never got to do before. And a few months passed, and it was time for his duck friends to come by, and he saw them in the sky and he decided, yes, it's time for me to go back and join my friends and be that kind of duck. And he flaps his wings and he doesn't take off. He hasn't flown in 3 months. His belly's like this because of all the corn he's been eating. His wings are weak and they need to be stretched out, and he can't get off the ground. And he decides, it's okay, I'll just wait here a few months, and when they fly overhead again, I'll join them. And he quacks at them and they quack at him, and off they go. And a few months later they come back, and he's been practicing and he's ready and he takes off, but he doesn't have the height and he flies right into the side of the barn. And he says, it's okay, I'll just wait a few months. And he does this month after month after month. He waits, the ducks come by, he tries to go and greet them and he can't. And after a while, he just forgets about them and he forgets about the other life, and he just settles into where he is. And as time goes by, he doesn't even hear the ducks as they fly by anymore. He doesn't even look up. Because after all, he's not that kind of duck. He's now a barnyard duck. And in light of today's sermon, we can take this story, and we have to stretch it a little bit, but we can take this story two ways. You can see Drake the duck as someone who got rid of that old self, put on that new self, and never looked back and lived his life the way that he thought was right. You can also see the story as the little duck who gave in to the temptations and things that came his way and let the ways of the world change him, and he became completely different for who he was and for who he was born to be. And it doesn't really matter which ending of the story you like, one, the other, both. Because both of them make the same point. In this life, we are given that ability to choose to be who we want to be, to do and say and live the way that we feel is right, or the way that we want. Now, I want you, and all of us here want to be the kind of lives that God is proud of. To do that, we need God in the center of our lives. So we need to banish those things that would take us away from God. We need to banish those things that would change us, that would give in to the ways of the world. And when God is in that right place with us, we can speak the truth. We can act by doing and saying the right things. We can live honestly and proudly. We can say to God every day, may my words be true and decent and kind. And may I always honor God's Spirit in my life. Let us pray. Gracious God, be with us this day. Help us to live. And help us to thank you for all you do for us. Amen.
Say that it's a real pleasure to have been the representative for Jeff Kollar here to join church. He was my confirmand. And it goes way back. I told his mother I wasn't going to get into too much, but I have known her since she was small. And then they started coming to our church. And the next thing I know, here comes this little guy, Jeffery. And I used to always, of course, me being me, I used to give him a high five or hit him on the back of the head as I was ushering as he was going over to sit down. And now Jeffery comes in, and I reach up to give him a high five, as you can see. So, and no, it was a real pleasure, and I would like to present Jeffery Kollar.
Letting my statement of faith has given me the opportunity to think about everything that has led me to this point in my faith journey. What my faith in Jesus Christ means to me is a sense of guidance where I'm uncertain about what to do, strength when I need it, love, and knowing that there is eternal life. I live out my love for Christ by being kind to others and spreading my love for Christ. I apply my faith in my everyday life by praying before I go to sleep every night, treating others with respect and kindness, and trying to be the best person I can be. A Bible verse that represents my faith is from the book of Luke, chapter 6, verse 35. Love your enemies, do good to them, lend to them without expecting to get anything back. Then you will receive a lot in return, and you will be sons of the Most High God. He is kind to people who are evil and are not thankful. I think that this Bible verse represents my faith, because I believe you should always be kind to others, and they treat you the same. My favorite person in the Bible is Moses. Moses is my favorite person because even though he was given to go to the Pharaoh and rescue the Israelites, he trusted God and was able to rescue his people. Moses also parted the Red Sea to escape the Pharaoh and his army, which I do not think he could have done without his strong faith in God. I hope to always have as much faith as Moses. My favorite Bible verse is Matthew chapter 10, verse 33. But what about someone who says in front of others that he doesn't know him? I will say in front of my Father who is in heaven that I don't know him. This is my favorite Bible verse because I think that it sends a strong message that you should not be ashamed of your faith when you are in front of others. I think that the purpose of the church in today's world is being a place for people to go to be closer to God. Today, churches also provide for people in need through food drives and clothing drives, and making sure that the less fortunate have a nice Christmas. One of my favorite memories from church was Vacation Bible School, when there was a youth theme every summer, and we would play games and learn about Christ. One of the things that we learned in confirmation class that I found most interesting was what it means to be a Presbyterian and what is different between Presbyterianism and other types of Christianity. Please bow your heads. Dear God, thank you for giving me my friends and family. Thank you for giving me my sponsor, Mr. Wilson. He has told me great stories and given me great advice throughout my confirmation. Thank you for my parents, who have been very supportive of me throughout my confirmation, and giving me good advice and helping my new year. Finally, thank you to Miss Erica, who has been so helpful during my confirmation, by answering my questions and teaching us lessons about the church and God. Thank you all for what you do for me each and every day. Amen.
Today with refreshments, and now go forth from here as a people who are sent. Wherever you go this week, consider that God is sending you there. Wherever you find yourself this week, consider that God is placing you there. That the love of Christ that dwells within you can reach out and touch others through you. Know this, go in God's love, God's peace, and God's power. Amen.
To the game.
All right.
Tuesday, Wednesday, and Friday.
All right.
Yeah, I'm not going to the Y at all next week.
All right.
In fact, I promise not to even drive the car next week because they want me to get used to being without it.
Right.
See, I'm going to start driving in a couple of nights.
All right.
See you later, kiddos.
I know.